graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents The Black River Irregulars, Murder in Corvis, by Richard Lee Byers. Narrated by Terence Aselford, with performances by Alejandro Ruiz, Scott McCormick, Bradley Smith, Joy Jones, Richard Rowan, David Jourdan, Yasmin Tuazon, Zeke Alton, Michael John Casey, Ken Jackson, Colleen Delany, Nathanial Perry, Eric Messner, Nanette Savard, Rose Elizabeth Supan, and Mort Shelby. The Black River Irregulars. Murder in Corvis. Out on the street, the light of gas lamps gleamed on cobbles slick with rain. The thoroughfare ran through a respectable neighborhood of prosperous shopkeepers and skilled tradesmen, and was too well illuminated for easy lurking. Happily, though, the narrow alley that intersected the street had no such lamps, and the recessed doorway where Milo Boggs stood was darker still. No one was likely to notice a smallish man in a long black cloak as he peered out at the locals' comings and goings. The soot-stained brick above his head even kept him out of the drizzle. None of the passers-by were of any use to Milo, and after a while, impatience started gnawing at him. Or perhaps it was the loneliness that occasionally crept up on him when he watched other people going about their lives.
Come on. Come on. Don't make me wait all night.
Moments later, a lone man in a foppish hat with an upturned brim and a gold cockade came into view. Pudgy, with a mottled, florid face, he stopped in front of the alley to take a silver flask from his pocket and unscrew the cap with the exaggerated care of the intoxicated. Milo smiled. It was as if Morrow, or one of the deity's ascendants, had answered his prayer, although he supposed the suggestion would appall a priest. More likely, they'd want to credit Thamar. The tippler drank, returned the flask to its pocket, and moved on. Milo gave him time to get a little farther away, then headed out onto the street to follow him. Now Milo simply needed the right spot at the proper moment, a dark patch where the gaslight didn't reach and nobody else was wandering by. As he awaited his opportunity, his hands checked the gear hidden beneath his cloak. One bandolier contained all the grenades it should, and the other, its full complement of throwing knives. He'd carefully buckled the sundry pouches incorporated into his alchemist's leather armor. Their contents wouldn't spill, even in the throes of violent exertion. Really, he'd already known he was prepared, but the little ritual settled his nerves. The drunkard paused for another nip from the flask, and then arrived at a spot where the street divided like a ribbon cut lengthwise, the left side remaining at ground level and the right sloping downward into the earth. He opted to descend. If he hadn't needed to keep silent, Milo might have laughed. First the drinking, now this. It was as if the fellow were trying to help him. Despite the target's manifest vulnerability, tackling him above ground would still have presented a certain amount of risk. But poorly lit and just as poorly patrolled, the domain of scoundrels who felt only contempt for victims and paupers who survived by keeping their heads down, the undercity of Corvis was the ideal place for a robbery. Milo wondered what a well-dressed, seemingly reputable fellow wanted in such a disreputable precinct of the city. Perhaps he harbored a taste for the sort of entertainments that were readily available there. In any case, if he were stupid enough to visit such a dangerous place alone and inebriated, then he deserved whatever befell him. The cobbles gave way to damp, rutted soil. Then the street leveled out in a cave with tunnels running off in three directions. Even here, a few gas lamps burned to half reveal the structures in the gloom. Tilted precariously, a ruinous house looked as if the constant subsidence of the city had long ago dropped it from the world above. A rickety staircase climbed to an opening halfway up the cavern wall. Several grimy, ragged men had lined up in front of a shack, painted with a crude line rendering of a naked woman, and a bored-looking ruffian with a club sat by the door to take their coins. The brothel keeper and patrons were unlikely to bestir themselves on the drunkard's behalf. Still, having waited this long, Milo might as well delay making his move until there were no witnesses at all. Especially since the fat man, in his helpful way, appeared headed for a less populous portion of the caverns. As Milo followed, he brought his gas mask out from under his cloak and slipped it over his head. The mask would protect him from catching a stray whiff of his own weapon. It would also keep the man in the fancy hat from noticing his pockmarks or anything else about his face. The tippler led him into a passage lined with the Undercity's version of tenements, or rather their charred and crumbling remains. Once, a landlord had jammed in hundreds of tenants, but then a fire broke out and killed them. No one had tried to do anything much with the space since. Rumor claimed it was unlucky, haunted, or accursed. But the tunnel was the quickest way from one populous section of the caves to another, and so people braved it and kept a couple of torches burning along the way. Still treading silently, Milo quickened his pace until he came within throwing distance of the oblivious figure in front of him. He then tugged a grenade from its bandolier, thumbed the exposed arc of cog that started the clockwork inside ticking, pulled the pin, and threw the metal orb. The grenade landed just behind the man in the hat. Startled, he whirled, and then the metal casing burst apart. If any of the scraps hit him, they were likely to sting, but the actual point of the detonation was the vapor that puffed from the ruptured shell. The pudgy man fumbled at his throat, the fancy hat tumbling off. He collapsed to his knees. Milo smiled. The strangle gas shouldn't asphyxiate its victim, not at this concentration, but it was doing a fine job of incapacitating him. Suddenly, Milo threw himself down. A quarrel streaked over him and stabbed into the earth. The angle told him his assailant had shot from an upper-story window in one of the burned tenements. Good. Whoever the bastard was, he'd likely made a slow, precarious climb through the wreckage to reach his perch and would have to descend just as carefully if he didn't want to break his neck. That meant his only option was to keep attacking at range, and the alchemist reckoned he knew how to spoil the other man's aim. He pulled loose a second grenade, thumbed the trigger cog, pulled the pin, and lobbed the metal ball in the direction from which the quarrel had flown. As the grenade rolled over the soft, uneven earth, a dark shape clambered through a third-floor window. Milo watched more in surprise than dismay. Only an idiot would jump from that high up. But that was what his attacker did. The swell of smoke kept Milo from seeing the crossbowman land. Then a hulking figure strode through the smoke screen. Milo's assailant had plainly accomplished the jump without breaking his legs or otherwise injuring himself, and now that the would-be robber was getting a closer look at him, he understood the reason why. The crossbowman wasn't actually a man at all. It was a trollkin, and thus stronger and sturdier than any human being. The trollkin had the massive frame and blue-green skin of his kind. Half his face was jaw, and most of the rest was sloping brow, with his wide mouth, nub of a nose, and beady eyes squashed in between. A strip of orange-red quills bristled atop his head. He wore plate armor with spikes jutting from it everywhere they could without impeding movement, carried a big steel shield, and had an equally impressive warhammer slung across his back. The crossbow now dangled from his belt. Milo rather wished he'd turned and run the instant he tossed the smoke grenade. He reminded himself that he'd bested a number of foes bigger than himself over the years. Still, few of them had been this big, and clearly it would be foolish to fight if he could trick his way out of trouble. He pointed at the pudgy man.
If you don't help him, he'll choke to death.
I doubt it. If his airways were going to close, it would have happened already. Besides, nobody's paying me to look after him. The bounty's on you.
Milo whirled and ran. The trollkin raced after him. Milo pulled his remaining strangle gas grenade from the bandolier, thumbed the cog, pulled the pin, and counted to two. Then, without looking back or breaking stride, he tossed the bomb over his shoulder. He'd practiced the move and was reasonably confident of landing the missile near his pursuer by sound and reckoning alone. Unfortunately, it exploded off to the right, not directly behind him. The Trollkin must have swatted it away with his shield just prior to detonation. Well then, Milo wouldn't give him the chance to knock away or otherwise avoid the next one. He pulled a bomb from the snug leather loop, holding it in place, and slowed his pace just a little, giving the Trollkin the chance to draw closer without being obvious about it. When he judged the moment was right, he thumbed the cog, counted to three, spun, and felt a pang of dismay to discover that the Trollkin was even nearer than expected. Still, his tactic ought to work. He pulled the pin and bowled the grenade, sending it to land under the Trollkin's feet. Vapor burst from the detonation, the cloud expanding enough to put Milo himself at the fringe of it. As expected, the Trollkin in his spiky armor froze in response to a sudden jolt of fear. In another moment, the hallucinations would begin. Then he might flail at them, try to flee from them, or simply stagger around recoiling from the imaginary terrors assailing him from every side. He started to circle around his erstwhile pursuer. Then, his wide mouth contorted in a grimace, the thief-taker lunged clear of the thinning cloud of gas. He slapped himself in the face once and then again, his dark little eyes locked on Milo. How had he shaken off the effects of the gas? Perhaps he'd had the wit to hold his breath as the grenade exploded and had inhaled only a trace of it. Or maybe his natural hardiness was to blame. Either way, he was now even closer than before. He rushed Milo, and once again the alchemist fled. If the grenades weren't working, he'd simply outrun his pursuer. Surely it wouldn't be that difficult. The Trollkin had plate armor weighing him down. Milo sprinted, striving for every iota of speed of which his legs were capable, and for a couple of moments was certain he was pulling ahead. Then something struck the back of his right calf and made him stumble. He looked down and discovered a crossbow bolt sticking in his leg. At the same instant, the wound started to throb. There was no time to tend the injury now. He ran on, but despite his best efforts, he couldn't entirely shut out the pain. It made him limp, and he was certain the Trollkin was catching up to him. So Milo stopped running, turned, and grabbed for a knife. But before he could throw the leaf-shaped blade, the Trollkin rammed the shield into his body. The crashing impact threw him off his feet and made him feel like a bell that had just been tolled and was vibrating still. He told himself that he had to keep fighting, had to. And then the Trollkin dropped his shield, maneuvered around behind him, took him by the neck, and squeezed. Gardek Stonebrow compressed the human's carotid artery until his quarry stopped squirming, then released his grip and looked him over. As intended, the blood choke had simply rendered the knife thrower unconscious, not dead. Good. Gardek had been advised that alive was preferable. Although actually still jumpy from the fear gas, he wouldn't have been especially upset to discover he'd killed the wretch. He'd taken this job knowing his quarry was dangerous, but even so, who would have expected one runt of a human to be so difficult to catch? Certainly not Gardek. Of course, pretty much everything about this night had surprised him. He'd had a hunch the object of his hunt would turn out to be undead, as those who claimed to have glimpsed his quarry had reported, a shrouded, misshapen, malodorous figure skulking through the dark. With that to build upon, his own wishful thinking had done the rest. 5 years ago, on the longest night, an army of the dead had assaulted Corvis, and Gardek's brother had been torn apart amid the horror and desperate fighting that followed. Gardek hadn't yet finished avenging him. He was reasonably certain he never would. And in consequence, no hunts pleased him more than those that ended with him hammering such abominations into splintered bone and spattered rot. Sadly, this chore hadn't turned out to be one of those. Still, it was a job, and now he needed to complete it and collect his pay. He removed the human's cloak and the bandoliers and armored alchemist's vest beneath, then rolled him onto his stomach to bind his hands behind him. Only then did he strip off the gas mask. The pocked face beneath was thin, almost haggard, that of a man who'd known hunger and hard times. An ordinary face, really. But Gardek had been a bounty hunter long enough to disabuse him of any notion that wrongdoers necessarily displayed their larceny for all to see. The best were those whose faces were easily forgotten. He stowed the human's belongings in the haversack he wore on his back along with his warhammer. Then he picked up the unconscious man, carefully, so as to avoid sticking him with a spike. The enhancements to his armor had their uses in battle, but sometimes complicated, mundane tasks.
You,
Gardek pivoted to discover it was his quarry's quarry who'd spoken. He'd worked so hard to catch the man in the gas mask that he'd essentially forgotten the plump little dandy.
I need to go home. I'll pay you to get me there safely.
I'm busy. Go quickly, before some other bastard takes an interest in you.
Gardek turned away without waiting to see if the man would heed his advice. He passed out the north end of the tunnel and through an enclave of gobbers with their gray-green skin and long, pointed ears. Some of the residents eyed him and his prisoner curiously, but no one was brave enough to accost him. After that, he turned into one of the many sections of cave no one had ever attempted to colonize, and where no torches or gas lamps burned. No matter. Shaken periodically, a lantern filled with bottled light got him from one end to the other. With a twinge of amusement, he wondered if his prisoner had been involved in the manufacture of the bottled light. It was possible. The alchemist might be a respected member of the Order of the Golden Crucible when he wasn't prowling around committing atrocities. It was in the next tunnel that the small man stirred. Gardek set him down, leashed him, and waited for him to finish waking. The alchemist's eyes fluttered open. Gardek had to give him credit. Although he must have been frightened, he did his best to keep that fear from showing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.